This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad. Good morning.
Good morning.
My name is Jim Aarons. I serve as Bishop of the La Crosse Area Synod of the Evangelical Lutheran Church of America. And it's my honor today to be presiding for Pastor Phil's installation as pastor here at Trinity. One of the joys of working in the pandemic is getting all of the electronics to work. So we're only about 5 minutes late. That's better than some services I've tried to see. And another frustration is you can't all be here for special days. So we welcome those who are streaming and representing you here, the invited guests, so that we have some people, are some church council members and some members of the call committee and a couple of special friends. We thank you for being here in person. We greatly thank the number of people who are watching at home. I bring you the greetings of the other 72 congregations of the La Crosse Area Synod. Some of them know what we're doing today. Some are holding us up in prayer and supporting the work that we do together as a body that reaches out even in a pandemic to be sure that the most vulnerable among us are served, to be sure the hungry are fed, to be sure the Word of God is preached. Thank you for all of the work that we do together. Now as we begin our worship, the Holy Spirit calls us together as the people of God. Therefore, let us prepare ourselves for worship. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God who forgives all our sin, whose mercy endures forever. Amen. God of all mercy and consolation, come to the help of your people, turning us from our sin to live for you alone. Give us the power of your Holy Spirit so that we may confess our sin, receive your forgiveness, and grow into the fullness of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen.
first reading today is from the book of Isaiah, chapter 25, verses 1 through 9. O Lord, you are my God. I will exalt you. I will praise your name. For you have done wonderful things, lands formed of old, faithful and sure. For you have made the city a heap, the fortified city a ruin. The palace will see no more. It will never be rebuilt. Therefore, strong peoples will glorify you. Cities of ruthless nations will fear you. For you have been a refuge to the poor, a refuge to the needy in their distress, a shelter from the ransom, and a shade from the heat. When the blast of the ruthless was like a winter rainstorm, the noise of aliens like heat in a dry place, you subdued the heat with the shade of clouds. The song of the ruthless was stilled. On this mountain, the Lord of hosts will make for all peoples a feast of rich food, a feast of well-aged wines, a rich food filled with marrow, of well-aged wines, strained clear. And he will destroy on this mountain the shroud that is cast over all peoples, the sheet that is spread over all nations. He will swallow up death forever. Then the Lord God will wipe away the tears from all faces, and the disgrace of his people he will take away from all the earth, for the Lord has spoken. It will be said on that day, Lo, this is our God. We have waited for him, so that he might save us. This is the Lord for whom we have waited. Let us be glad and rejoice in his salvation. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Today's second reading is from the letter of Paul to the Philippians, chapter 4, verses 1 through 9. My brothers and sisters, whom I love and long for, my joy and crown, stand firm in the Lord in this way, my beloved. I urge Euodia and I urge Syntyche to be of the same mind in the Lord. Yes, and ask you also, my loyal companion, help these women, for they have struggled beside me in the work of the gospel, together with Clement and the rest of my co-workers, whose names are in your book of life. Rejoice in the Lord always. Again I will say, rejoice. Let your gentleness be known to everyone. The Lord is near. Do not worry about anything, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your request be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Finally, beloved, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is pleasing, whatever is commendable, if there is any anything worthy of praise, think about these things. Keep on doing the things that you have learned and received and heard and seen in me, and the God of peace will be with you. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Decide about worshiping in person, decide
decide about how we communicate, decide about caring for the most vulnerable among us, has meant I've hurt a lot. And it means I know that you're okay if I take my mask off up here. It'll go back on when I step away. Dear friends, grace and peace be unto you from God our Father, to the saving power of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the wonderful presence of God's most mysterious and powerful Holy Spirit. Amen. This morning's gospel is recorded in the 22nd chapter of Matthew, beginning with the first verse. Once more, Jesus spoke to them in parables, saying, "The kingdom of heaven may be compared to a king who gave a wedding banquet for his son. He sent his slaves to call those who had been invited to the wedding banquet, but they would not come. Again, he sent other slaves, saying, 'Tell those who have been invited, look, I've prepared my dinner, my oxen and my fat calves have been slaughtered, and everything is ready. Come to the wedding banquet.' But they made light of it and went away. One to his farm, another to his business, while the rest seized his slaves, mistreated them, and killed them. The king was enraged. He sent his troops, destroyed those murderers, and burned the city. And he said to his slaves, 'The wedding is ready, but those invited are not worthy. Go therefore into the main streets and invite everyone you find to the wedding banquet.' Slaves went out into the streets and gathered all whom they found, both good and bad. So the wedding hall was filled with guests. But when the king came in to see the guests, he noticed a man who was not wearing a wedding robe. And he said to him, 'Friend, how did you get in here without a wedding robe?' And he was speechless. Then the king said to the attendants, 'Bind him hand and foot and throw him into the outer darkness, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. For many are called, but few were chosen.'" The gospel, the good news of the Lord. Doesn't sound like good news, does it? If you've been checking in on worship over the last few weeks, you've had the joy of hearing a very plain-spoken Jesus addressing the scribes and Pharisees, the religious leaders of his day, the people we would see in Sunday school teachers, pastors, church council members, those who know it so well that their knowledge is going to save them. And Jesus has spent the last few weeks making pretty clear points about hypocrisy, about unpreparedness, about judging. And it's just not the best text for the installation of a pastor. So I want to address my remarks specifically to the second lesson for today from Philippians, where Paul is being a good pastor, as we pray that Pastor Phil is going to continue to be. He's addressing a congregation who has heard the good news. That good news has filled them, and they know that Jesus Christ lived and died and lives for them. They know that they are people of grace, gifted by God. Paul is so sure that they know that, that he gives them some extra promises about being people of grace. He says to them, "Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I will say rejoice." People that know the good news of Jesus know that Jesus brings joy. And as people of joy, we find it. He also says, "The peace of God, which passes all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus." People who know Jesus and know that joy can have a peace of heart, a peace of living health that we've been in the middle of a year where we realize how many ways we have not been true to the full humanity in our country. The ways we're living on an understanding of people of color as being less than us, but they're not. And in the middle of that, we have an election going on. Anybody enjoying the commercials? Yeah, me neither. Be very, very afraid. But my candidate is going on a rabbit hunt, and you'll be okay with him. Just vote for him. Everybody's short-tempered, pointing fingers. No, they have the right answer. In the middle of that, Paul calls Pastor Phil and the people of Trinity to be people of Jesus, people of joy, people of peace. And that calls on us to do something very, very difficult, even with Jesus' peace and joy filling us. When we get in the middle of those conversations, when we hear the derision and the anger and the divisiveness, when we're in the middle of the anxiety and the short tempers, Paul tells these new Christians, people of Jesus, joy and peace, finally, beloved, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is pleasing, whatever is commendable, if there is any excellence, and if there is anything worthy of praise, think about these things. What if, in the middle of all of our lid coming up, we take a deep breath, welcoming in the Spirit of God, which gives us time to remember that we're Jesus people, and joy people, and peace people, giving us time to think about, first of all, whether we need to enter into the discussion, and secondly, if we do, how do we enter in pointing to the honorable, pointing to the gentleness, pointing to the true? If there is anything that is excellent, if there is anything worthy of praise, how do we bring that in? How do we remember, first of all, we belong to Jesus? And Jesus has a hold of us. And Jesus has not let go of us in pandemic and protest and elections. Jesus holds us. With an open hand, I love you, but be my people. I love you, live as my people. I love you, speak as my people. I love you, be my people in this very difficult world. And remember that promise from Matthew. Jesus says, and lo, I am with you always. Always. Close of this sermon, to the close of this service, to the close of our service, to the close of the age, Jesus is with us. continue in these things or in doing this, you will save both yourself and your hearers. Pastor Phil, in the presence of this assembly, will you commit yourself to this new trust and responsibility and the confidence that it comes from God through the call of the church?
I will, and I ask God to help me.
Will you preach and teach in accordance with the Holy Scriptures and with the confessions of the Lutheran Church? Will you carry out this ministry in harmony with the constitutions of the Evangelical Lutheran Church?
And I ask God to help me.
Will you be diligent in your study of the Holy Scriptures and in your use of the means of grace? Will you love, serve, and pray for God's people, nourish them with the word and sacraments, and lead them by your own example in faithful service and holy living?
I will, and I ask God to help me.
Will you give faithful witness in the world that God's love may be known in all that you do?
I will, and I ask God to help me.
Almighty God, who's given you the will to do these things, graciously give you the strength and compassion to perform them.
Amen.
Invite the assembly to stand and begin to speak for the whole congregation. People of God, will you receive Pastor Phil as a messenger of Jesus Christ sent to serve all people with the gospel of hope and salvation? Will you regard him as a servant of Christ and a steward of the mysteries of God?
We will, and ask God to help us.
Will you pray for him, help and honor him for his work's sake, and in all things strive to live together in the peace and unity of Christ? Pastor Phil, the office of pastor is now committed to you in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Let's have you kneel. Let us pray. God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus Christ, the great shepherd of the sheep, by the blood of the eternal covenant, make you complete in everything good, so that you may do God's will, working in you that which is pleasing in God's sight, through Jesus Christ, to whom be the glory forever and ever. Amen. Congregation, may be seated. A little reminder of why you're here. Him to you so that you can clap and thank him for coming. There's a person who really wishes she could be here today, among many folks who wish they could be here today. But this one's mom, so she gets a special note. The note says, "Make a joyful noise to the Lord, all the lands. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come into his presence with singing." My dear son, I am sorry that your family cannot be physically present with you today. This is the second time COVID has prevented us from being together for a happy occasion. You were missing from our wedding in July, but we are always a family no matter where you are. God made us a family, and we're always connected wherever we are. I should like to live by three of my favorite verses, Jeremiah 29, Romans 8, and of course, John 3:16. God is now taking you to Wisconsin. Taking you, she has an issue. taking you to Wisconsin to serve him and giving you a church family to care for. I pray that your work goes according to God's plan. When COVID lets up, we will come up to visit. I'm thankful to be able to watch on Zoom. It makes it a little easier since we can't be there in person. May God bless and guide you at Trinity Lutheran. I pray that joyful noise can be made soon. Love always. Thank you. People of God, I present to you Phillip Waselik, your pastor. Let us welcome him in the name of Christ.
With confidence in God's grace and mercy, let us pray for the church, the world, and all those who are in need. Gracious host, fill your church with a spirit of joyous hospitality. We pray for bishops, teachers, church leaders, and all children of God as they invite others to your table of boundless grace. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Gracious host, as creation waits with eager longing for redemption, protect your creatures that are mistreated. Restore valleys, mountains, and pastures, and still and running waters. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Gracious host, as you set a table in the presence of enemies, so bless the efforts of diplomats, international peace workers, and world leaders who navigate conflict. May they proceed with dialogue and understanding so that justice and peace prevails. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Gracious host, let your gentleness be known among those who are weary or ill, especially at this time. Strengthen doctors, medical workers, and caregivers who see to their needs. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Gracious host, when we are quick to judge outward appearance, remind us how you clothe all in your mercy. We pray for ministries that provide needed clothing and other personal care assistance
and your love endures forever. You bring forth bread from the earth and fruit from the vine. Nourish us with these gifts, that we might be for the world signs of your gracious presence in Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God. Through our Savior, today overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so, with the choirs of angels, with the church on earth, and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup and gave thanks and gave it to all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this in remembrance of me." For often as we eat of this bread and drink of this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Remembering therefore his salutary command, his life-giving passion and death, his glorious resurrection and ascension, and the promise of his coming again, we give thanks to you, O Lord, Almighty God. Not as we ought, but as we are able, we ask you mercifully to accept our praise and thanksgiving, and with your word and holy words, and these your own gifts of bread and wine, so that we and all who share in the body and blood of Christ may be filled with the heavenly blessing and grace, and receiving the forgiveness of sin, may be formed to live as your holy people, and be given our inheritance with all your saints. To you, O God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be all honor and glory in your holy church, now and forever. Amen. So gather together as one universal church, let us pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. So come to the banquet table. All are welcome, and is now ready. You have your little kits. You are welcome to share with each other if you're family.
body of Christ given for you, and the blood of Christ shed for you. Let us pray. God of abundance, with this bread of life and cup of salvation, you have united us with Christ, making us one with all your people. Now send us forth in the power of your Spirit, that we may proclaim your redeeming love to the world and continue forever in the risen life of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The closing hymn, if you listen to the radio this morning, we have a different song now, one of my favorites.
Voices, angels above.
bless you and keep you. May the Lord's face shine on you with grace and mercy. May the Lord look upon you with favor and give you all peace.
Amen.
I want to share with you about what joy it is that you are all able to join us today, even though it's a percentage of the church. And thank you for everybody who joined us on Facebook Live and our family at home. And you are all family. You're the body of Christ. You are all now entering God's mission field. So let us go in peace, comfort, love, and joy.